Hello everyone, welcome to another American Girl of the Week video. We are working our way through Molly, so right now we're going to be reading Molly Saves the Day, which is book 5 in the Molly series. Chapter 1, Camp Gowanigan. Molly McIntyre loved Camp Gowanigan from the very first day she was there. Molly and her friends Linda and Susan had never gone to summer camp before. They were a little nervous when the big old bus that brought them from home stopped inside the camp gates. But as soon as they stepped off the bus with all the other campers, they were met by a cheering Camp Gowanigan counselors. The counselors sang to them, "Welcome to Camp Gowanigan. We're mighty glad you're here. Hurrah, hurrah for Gowanigan. Hail, hail, let's have a cheer." "Gosh," said Susan, "this is neat." Molly just grinned happily. A roly-poly woman came towards them. She was beaming. "Hello, girl," she said. "My name is Miss Butternut. I'm the camp director. Welcome to Camp Gowanigan. The counselors and I are very happy you're here." "Hooray," cheered the counselors. Miss Butternut laughed. "You see," she said to the campers, "we're going to have a wonderful time. Now, if you'll follow me, I'll show you to your tents." The girls gathered their suitcases and duffel bags and followed Miss Butternut up the shady path. There were big brown tents on one side of the path. On the other side, Molly saw wide green fields edged with darker green pine trees. The open fields sloped down to a silver-blue lake with the island in the middle. "It's beautiful here," Molly said. "Yes," said Linda. "There's so much sky." Miss Butternut led Molly, Linda, and Susan to tent number 6, where they would live with 5 other girls. As they carried their gear into the roomy tent, Miss Butternut smiled and said, "Here you are. This is your home sweet home for the next 2 weeks. Remember our Camp Gowanigan motto, tidy and true. Keep your tent neat and clean. Then you'll be comfortable and happy here at Camp Gowanigan." Molly was comfortable and happy at camp right away. The counselors were so nice and friendly. They made everything so fun and easy. Molly, Linda, and Susan soon made friends with the other girls in their tent and lots of the other campers. Old campers, girls who had been at camp last year, taught them the camp songs and cheers. Molly liked the cheer that went, "Go on again, go on again, go on again and try, clap, clap. You can win, you can win, go on again and try, clap, clap." In just a few days, Molly felt like one of the old campers herself. She knew all the rules and the way everything was done at Camp Gowanigan. She and Linda and Susan kept their tents and their belongings in order. Even Linda, who was messy at home, tried to live up to the tidy part of the camp motto. She always tied her camp tie and kept her shirt tucked in, just like the counselors did. There was something for everyone at Camp Gowanigan. Linda liked using bows and arrows and archery. Susan liked campfires, sing-alongs, and weenie roasts. Molly liked nature hikes when Miss Butternut taught them the names of the plants and the trees and the birds. Every day the girls learned something new. Every day was so busy and so much fun, the time just flew by. Days at camp began early. Miss Butternut stood by the flagpole and blew a cheerful tune on her bugle. The words to the tune were, "I can't get 'em up, I can't get 'em up, I can't get 'em up in the morning." But in Molly's case, the words were wrong. She couldn't wait to get up in the morning and begin the day. There was so much to do. First, there was morning flag-raising ceremony and breakfast in the dining hall. Then the campers played games of softball, volleyball, and basketball. They had lessons in swimming, tennis, and sailing. On rainy days, they worked on their arts and craft projects. Susan was making a leaf and bark chart. Molly was making a sit-upon. She folded a piece of oilcloth around the old newspaper and sewed the edges together. Linda was braiding strings together to make a lanyard, a cord to hang a whistle on and wear around her neck. All the counselors had lanyards. Linda noticed everything about the counselors. One of Molly's favorite times at camp was evening flag lowering ceremony. She liked it because all the girls and all the counselors stood together and sang the Camp Gowanigan song. "God bless Gowanigan, camp that we love. Raise the flag high, never say die, while the red, white, and blue flies above." Molly always got goosebumps up and down her arms when they sang the camp song. Standing shoulder to shoulder with all the other campers made her feel proud. She did love Camp Gowanigan. She was glad to be there with her 2 best friends. One evening, after the flag was lowered and folded, Miss Butternut said, "Before we go up to dinner, I'm pleased to tell you the winner of the Camp Gowanigan canoe race. First place goes to Dorinda Brassy. Let's have a cheer for Dorinda." All the campers cheered, "Hip hip hooray! Hip hip hooray!" Dorinda looked smug as everyone cheered. She was an old camper, and she was used to winning. Miss Butternut went on in her kindly way. "And what do we say to a new camper who came in last?" All the campers cheered, "Go on again, go on again, go on again and try. You can win, go on again and try." Miss Butternut nodded happily. "That's the spirit," she said. "Here at Camp Gowanigan, we know that trying is as important as winning," she smiled. "All right, girls, I'll see you in the dining hall in 2 minutes. "Go on again and try," repeated Susan as girls walked up to the dining hall. "I do try. I just can't get my canoe to go straight." Susan was a camper who came in last in the canoe race. "No matter what I do, my paddle won't work right." She sighed. Well, said Linda glumly, don't worry. Pretty soon, we'll be home, and there's no place to paddle except the bathtub. We only have 3 more days here. She looked around sadly. I'm going to miss camp. Oh, me too, said Susan. I'm going to miss absolutely everything at camp except canoeing. She looked at Molly. You probably feel exactly the same way I do, Molly. You're going to miss everything at camp except swimming underwater, right? You hate that the way I hate canoeing. Molly didn't say anything. She was a little embarrassed. She wished Susan wouldn't compare her poor canoeing with Molly's swimming. I don't hate swimming, Molly said a little crossly. I just don't like being underwater. But you don't have to blab it all over the place. I'm not blabbing it, said Susan. Everybody in the whole camp knows you won't jump in the water or even get your head wet. We all saw you fall off the dock and almost drowned that time. Yeah, said Linda. We saw the counselor save your life. Remember how they jumped right in and pulled you out? Molly certainly did remember. She would never forget the day she slipped off the dock and fell into the deep water. The dark, dense green water closed over her head. She couldn't see or breathe or move. Though she was only under the water for a few seconds, it seemed like a long, long time to Molly. After the counselors pulled her out, Miss Butternut sat next to her holding her wet bathing cap until Molly called her breath. Don't you worry, said Miss Butternut. You'll swim underwater when you're good and ready. But camp was almost over, and Molly was no closer to swimming underwater than ever. Look at it this way, said Susan cheerfully, as they sat down at their table in the dining hall. You and I will just have to come back to camp next summer so we can go on again and try, Molly and Linda chimed in, and Molly had to laugh. Just as they finished dinner, Miss Butternut stood up and said, Tonight, girls, I have a special announcement to make. She rose up on her toes as if it was good news, was trying to spill out by itself. When everybody was quiet, she went on, One of our favorite traditions here at Camp Gowanigan is our game of color war. Whistles and cheers rang out through the dining hall. Miss Butternut smiled. I can see that the old campers remember how much of fun color war is. I know the new campers will love it, too. Now, when we play color war, the whole camp is divided into 2 teams, the reds and the blues. The team lists are on the doors. You may see which team you're on when you leave. Everyone quickly swung around to look at the doors, as if something as exciting as lists may shoot off sparks. But the doors looked as quiet as usual. Tomorrow morning, said Miss Butternut, the red team will paddle canoes across the narrow part of the lake to Chocolate Drop Island. They'll put a flag at the top of the hill there. Then it'll be red team's job to guard the flag. The blue team will have its headquarters here at camp, at the boathouse. They'll try to figure out a way to capture the flag from the reds. The team that has the flag at the sundown will win the game. Miss Butternut went on. When the blues try to capture the flag, they have to be very fast and very smart, or the red team will catch them and put them in prison. Prisoners can be freed only if someone from their own team takes them without being caught by the prison guard. Miss Butternut's eyes twinkled. One last thing, she said. The counselors and I will be watching you to be sure everyone is safe. But we will be well hidden, so you probably won't see us. The counselor smiled and nodded. Any questions, asked Miss Butternut. Dorinda Brassy raised her hand. When will we choose a leader, she said. Both teams will meet after dinner to elect their captain, said Miss Butternut. Anyone may be elected. Just look at Dorinda, whispered Linda. She looks so sure she's going to be leader. Molly looked. Linda was right. Dorinda and her friend Patty already seemed to be taking command. Molly envied them. It'd be neat to be in charge. Molly pictured herself leading a team to victory. Her team would capture the flag and canoe it back to camp, with everyone cheering and clapping and singing the camp song. Off you go, said Miss Butternut. Molly was practically knocked off her chair by the campers charging to see the team list. By the time Molly got to the doors, she was too far back in the crowd to see anything. But Linda elbowed her way through the crowd to the front, then elbowed her way back to report to Molly and Susan. You two are blues. I'm a red. Does that mean we're enemies, said Susan? Not until tomorrow, said Linda with a grin. I've got to go now. The red team is meeting in the tent number 4 to elect a leader. I bet you my bug repellent it'll be Patty. See you later. She waved as the red swarmed out the door. Later that night, when all the campers were settled into their cots, they heard Mrs. Butternut play taps on her bugle. That was a signal for lights out. Molly listened for the bugle's gentle song. The girls in the tent sang along softly. Day is done, gone the sun, from the lakes, from the hills, from the sky. All is well, safely rest, God is nigh. Usually, Molly drifted off to sleep peacefully, wondering what a wonderful activity the next day would bring. But tonight she was too wound up. She turned on her flashlight, rolled over on her side, and whispered to Linda and Susan. Are you asleep? Nope, said Susan. Neither am I, said Linda. What's the matter? I've been thinking, said Molly. I'm not so sure I like the idea of color war. Me either, said Susan. How come, asked Linda. She flopped onto her stomach and propped her chin on her pillow. Well, in the first place, how do we know what to do, asked Molly. I've never been in a color war before. Listen, said Linda, isn't Miss first place Dorinda the captain of your team? You can bet she will tell you and all the rest of the Blues exactly what to do. That's just it, said Molly. The game sounded like fun when Miss Butter and I explained it at dinner. But you should have seen Dorinda at our team meeting. As soon as she was chosen captain, she started calling us the Blue Army. And she was so serious. She acted like a general of a real army. Molly's right, Susan agreed. Dorinda's awfully bossy. Yeah, said Molly. And what if she tells me to do something terrible? Like dive in over your head and swim underwater, Linda finished for her. Dorinda tells you to dive? Tell her to go jump in the lake. Get it? It's not a joke, Linda, said Molly. Dorinda's in charge now. I have to do what she says. Yes, said Susan. We're in Dorinda's army now. We have to follow her orders. Everything is different. I like the way camp was before, said Molly. I don't see why we'd have to mess everything up and go capturing flags. Especially in canoes, added Susan. Linda shook her head. It's just a game. It's supposed to be fun, not something to worry about. I mean, if we're going off on a real war or something, then I could see being worried and scared. Molly nodded. My dad told us he was scared before he went away to the war, she said. But he says it's okay to be scared because that meant he had a chance to be brave. Well, maybe this color war will give us a chance to be brave, said Linda. If you can do something you're scared to do, then you're brave. That's easy for you to say, said Susan. You're not scared of canoeing like I am, or swimming underwater like Molly is. Yeah, said Molly. You're not scared of anything. Oh, yes, I am, said Linda. Like what, asked Susan. Well, said Linda, it's really stupid, but I'm scared of creepy crawly things like spiders and bugs. Worms are the worst. Linda moved her fingers like wiggling worms and made a face so that Molly and Susan had a laugh. Slimy worms. Ugh, I hate them. Really? Said Molly. It cheered her up to know that Linda was scared of something sort of silly, like worms. Yes, really, said Linda, but at least I can joke about it. You don't see me lying awake at night worrying about it. So don't you two worry about Dorinda or canoes or swimming underwater. Don't take this color war so seriously. It won't last forever, right? Right, said Molly and Susan. Okay, said Linda. She rolled over and pulled her blankets up to her chin. Go to sleep, and that's an order. Yes, sir, giggled Susan. She rolled over and closed her eyes. Molly turned off her flashlight and closed her eyes, but she didn't follow the order. She didn't fall asleep for a long, long time. Linda wasn't worried about the color war, but Molly still was. Maybe the color war would just be her big chance to be brave, but she wondered if she really wanted that chance. Chapter 2. We're in the army now. The next morning, every camper put on the red armband or blue armband to show which team she was on. Right after breakfast, the red team left the dining hall with a flag. Molly and Susan watched Linda march down the path toward the red canoes with the rest of her team. They were like an army, parading two by two like soldiers, carrying their bag of lunches and singing, "We are the Reds, mighty, mighty Reds. Everywhere we go, oh, people want to know, oh, who we are. So we tell them, we are the Reds, mighty, mighty Reds." Linda turned around and rolled her eyes at Molly. Molly grinned. She remembered what Linda said last night about not taking color war too seriously. I should be more like Linda, Molly thought. But she snapped to attention when Dorinda said in her bossiest voice, "Blue Army, report to HQ on the double." HQ, Susan asked Molly. Who's that? It's not a person, it's a place, said Molly. HQ stands for headquarters. I think she means the boathouse. Let's go. Molly and Susan followed the rest of the Blue Army to the boathouse. Two girls stood as guards at the door in case the Red Army had left spies behind. When she got the signal that the coast was clear, Dorinda began. She frowned at the girls. We are going to win this color war, she said sternly. And the only way to win is to fight as hard as we can. Do you understand? Everyone mumbled, yes. All right, Dorinda went on. Here's the plan of attack. The flag is on Chocolate Drop Island. To get it, we obviously have to canoe across the lake. You will each be assigned a buddy. You and your buddy will paddle a canoe together. We will load up and begin the attack at 0900. 0900? Susan whispered to Molly. Where is that? It's not a place, it's a time, said Molly. It's the army way to say 9 o'clock. Well, why doesn't she just say 9 o'clock, asked Susan. We're a team, but we're not really an army. Molly put her finger to her lips. Dorinda was scowling at her and Susan. Pay attention, troops, Dorinda ordered. She turned around and uncovered a big map of Camp Gowanigan tacked to the wall. Everyone said, ooh. The map looked as if it had been very carefully drawn. Molly realized Dorinda and her helpers must have been up all night making it. Molly's heart sank. Under Dorinda's command, the color war seemed less and less like a game among friends and more like a war between enemies. The map showed the boathouse, the lake, and Chocolate Drop Island. Dorinda used a long stick to point to places on the map as she talked. First, she pointed to the boathouse. We will set out from here, she said. Then she pointed to a place on the far side of Chocolate Drop Island, labeled Beach. We will land here. From the beach, we will march up Chocolate Drop Hill. I will capture the flag. The rest of you will take the Red Army prisoner. You will lead the prisoners back to your canoes and return them to HQ. I will meet you here no later than 10:00. She means 10 o'clock, right? Susan asked Molly. But Molly wasn't listening to Susan. There was something else she didn't understand. It wasn't the plan. She perfectly understood the plan. The plan was easy. In fact, it was too easy. Much too easy. Timidly, Molly raised her hand. Everyone turned around and stared at her. Yes, snapped Dorinda. Molly stood up. She clasped her hands behind her back. I get the plan, she said. I know what we're supposed to do. But I wonder what they're going to do. The Red Army. I mean, won't they have scouts who will see us coming across the lake? The lake isn't very wide there. How do you think we should cross the lake? Dorinda said sharply. Should we swim underwater? Molly's hands were clammy. Everyone at camp knew she hated to swim underwater. She wanted to sit down, but she made herself speak up. I just think the Red Army will be waiting for us at the beach when we land. They'll be ready to take all of us prisoner. Is there any place we could land where they wouldn't see us? No, said Dorinda. Those are my orders. But, Molly started to say, but what if... Dorinda crossed her arms over her chest and said, if you're too chicken to do this, you can stay behind. Be a deserter. Otherwise, go with your friend Susan. The two of you can be buddies and bring up the rear in your canoe. That way, the rest of us can protect you. Molly sat down, shamed into quiet. She pretended to straighten her blue armband. Now, go to the canoes. The rest of the buddy assignments will be made there, said Dorinda. Everyone filed out of the boathouse. No one would look at Molly. Susan and Molly walked slowly over to the last canoe on the shore. How come we don't get lunches like Red Army did? Asked Susan. Won't we get hungry? We shouldn't need lunches, said Molly. We're supposed to be back here by 10 o'clock, remember? Oh, yeah, said Susan. She looked longingly at the dining hall. Head out, they heard Dorinda yell. All the blues cheered and waved their canoe paddles in the air. Molly pushed the canoe into the water. She started to climb in the back. Wait, said Susan. I don't want to sit up in the front. I'll get splashed by the waves up there. Molly looked at the water. It was as flat as glass, but she said, okay, you can sit in back. Susan looked uncertain. No, she said. I don't want to sit in back either. The back person does all the work. You know how bad I am at steering and everything. Hurry and make up your mind, said Molly. The other canoes are already halfway to the island. Okay, okay, said Susan. I'll go in front, but don't paddle too fast. The canoe wobbled from side to side as Susan climbed in. See, she squeaked. I always get the tippiest canoe. She inched her way to the seat in the front, clutching the sides of the canoe with both hands. When she was seated, Molly handed her a paddle, shoved the canoe into deeper water, and climbed in the back. The other canoes were all way ahead of them, strung out across the lake like a family of ducks. As she and Susan paddled closer to the island, Molly could see the Red Scout watching them from a high point on the island shore. The Scout turned and ran towards the back of the side of the island. She's going to the beach to warn everyone, Molly thought with a sinking feeling. The whole and entire Red team will be waiting for us at the beach. They're going to put us in prison. I just know it. The rest of the blue canoes had already paddled around the backside of the island, out of Molly's sight. Come on, she said to Susan. We better catch up with the others. She dug her paddle deep into the water. Susan dug her paddle in too. Then she shrieked, my paddle! I dropped it! Molly saw Susan's paddle floating towards her. She put her own paddle in the bottom of the canoe and reached out with both hands to grab Susan's paddle. Susan was reaching too, leaning way out of the side of the canoe. Don't, yelled Molly, but it was too late. Over went Susan, over went the canoe, over went Molly. Down, down into the water, Molly sank, down into the dark green depths. Molly struggled with all her strength, pulling with one arm, grabbing onto her glasses with her other hand, kicking her legs, wiggling and fighting her way up. Finally, her head popped out into the sunshine. Molly coughed and choked on the water she had swallowed. She gasped for air. Over here, Molly heard Susan shout. She looked around. Susan was behind her, holding onto the canoe. Come on, Susan said. Grab the canoe. Molly swam towards Susan. She held her head high out of the water. It felt odd, swimming in her clothes. Her shoes felt like weights dragging her feet down. Molly kicked hard. The canoe was right side up, but it was half full of water. Her paddle floated inside the big puddle. Molly held onto the canoe and tried to catch her breath. I'm so sorry, Susan wailed. Are you okay? What will we do? Go to shore, said Molly in a shaky voice. I think I see a place to land. They were not far from the island. Both girls held onto the canoe with one arm and pushed through the water with the other arm. As they came to the shore, Molly saw a place where the water cut into the land. She and Susan pushed the canoe into the cut. It was narrow, not much wider than the canoe. They scrambled out of the water and sat on the rocks panting. Molly was trembling. Gosh, Susan whispered. I hope the Red Team doesn't catch us. Molly looked around. They were completely hidden by high rocky land on one side and tall pine trees on the other. I don't think anyone can see us here, she said. The scout is on the other side of those trees, and I think the rest of them are on the far side of the island, on the beach. Probably no one knows about this little place to land. But we better not stay long. Let's bail out the canoe. Molly and Susan scooped water out of the canoe with their Camp Gowanigan hats. When they were still about 3 inches of the water splashing around in the bottom of the canoe, Susan said, "My arms are killing me. Can we stop now?" "Okay," said Molly. "Her arms hurt too. Let's go." "Good," said Susan. "I'm so hungry and I want to change my clothes." "Oh, we can't go back to camp," said Molly firmly. "We have to go on and find the rest of the army." Susan protested, "But it's nearly lunchtime and I lost my paddle." "I'll paddle," said Molly. She stood up. Wearily, Susan climbed back into the canoe. "We're probably better off if I don't have a paddle," she said. "We sure can't do any worse." Molly pushed the canoe back into the lake by pushing against the rocks with her paddle. Then, slowly, she paddled around the corner of the island until they could see the beach. "Uh-oh," said Susan. All the blue canoes were dragged out of the water onto the one side of the beach. Paddles stuck out every which way. The canoes looked as helpless as tipped-over turtles, waving their legs in the air. All the girls in the blue army were sitting behind the canoes in a bushy corner of the beach. A big sign on one bush read, "Prison." "Look at that," said Susan. "They got our whole team in their prison, exactly like you said they would." Standing in front of the prison was a watchful guard with a big whistle and a lanyard around her neck. Molly squinted at the guard through her water-stained glasses. She gasped, "It's Linda! Their guard is Linda!" Molly was surprised. She certainly had not expected Linda to have such an important job to do. "Oh, good," said Susan, relieved. "She can help us." Susan waved her arms above her head. "Yoo-hoo, Linda, it's us," she shouted. "Help!" "Susan, I don't know if," Molly began. At that second, Linda looked straight at Susan and Molly. She put her whistle in her mouth and blew one shrill blast after another. She ran to the water, swooping towards them like a hawk in attack, waving her arms wildly and pointing to their canoe. 5 or 6 girls in red armbands ran across the beach towards her. "They'll catch us," cried Molly. "Let's get out of here." She paddled hard. Susan stuck her arms in the water and used her hands as paddles. Luckily, the canoe was pretty far out in the lake, and it scooted around to the other side of the island before the red canoes were even in the water. But Molly didn't stop paddling as hard as she could until she and Susan were all the way across the lake, safe in the boathouse. Silently, Molly and Susan hauled their canoe out of the water. It was the only canoe on the shore, the last blue canoe that was free, and it looked lonely. Molly's shoulders were sore. Her hands hurt from gripping the paddle. Susan shook her head. "I can't believe Linda would send them out to get us like that," she said. "We're her friends." "I know," said Molly, "and Linda told us she wasn't going to take the color war too seriously." "She must have changed her mind," said Susan. "She sure looked serious back there." "Yeah," said Molly. "She's as serious as Dorinda." Molly felt as if Linda had tricked her in some way. Last night, Linda said that the war would be so much fun. So far, it had been not very much fun for Molly, that was for sure. "First, I practically drowned," she thought. "Then, even worse, my best friend treats me like an enemy. I guess friendship doesn't count in war." Molly and Susan trudged up the hill to their tent. Molly was thinking hard. "After we change clothes, maybe we can dig up some lunch," said Susan. She sounded cheerful. "First, we better dig up a plan," said Molly. She sounded serious. Chapter 3. Creepy Crawlies. "They don't have to be real worms. She just has to think they're worms," said Molly. She and Susan were crawling in the dirt under the wooden platform beneath their tent. They were digging with the cups from their mess kit to find worms. "We can use bugs and spiders, too. I saw lots of them under here last week during camp cleanup. And get sticks and stems like this, see?" Molly held up a stem. It was brown and slimy enough to look like a worm. "Ugh," said Susan. "I don't like this plan. I think it's mean." Molly sighed. "Do you have another idea?" she asked. "No," said Susan. "But I don't see why we have to do something so mean to Linda. She's our best friend." "We're not doing it to Linda," said Molly. "We're doing it to the Red Army. You can't think of people as people during war. You think of them as part of the army." "Well," Susan began. "Look," Molly said sharply, "Linda sure wasn't thinking of us as her friends when she blew the whistle on us, did she?" "No," admitted Susan. "So we shouldn't think of her as our friend Linda. We should think of her as a guard for the Red Army. She's got our whole army in her prison. We have to get them free or we won't have a chance to capture the flag and win the color war." "That's why we have to do this," said Molly. This was Molly's plan. It depended on worms. Molly and Susan grubbed in the dirt on their hands and knees. Molly's shirt stuck to her back. Susan's face was red and sweaty. "I sweated so much, and I'm wetter than when we fell in the lake," complained Susan. "Well, we better stop," said Molly. Her hands were grimy. Susan held up an old tin can. It was only half full of worms and bugs and stems. "There's not very much stuff in here," she said. "There's not very much time," said Molly. "We have to go now." "Okay," said Susan. She and Molly wiggled like worms themselves to get out from under the tent. The sky was white hot as they plodded back to the boathouse. Molly pushed the canoe into the water. She started to get in the back. Susan said, "No, sir, I'm not getting in the front again. That's the tippiest part." "No, it isn't," said Molly. But Susan was stubborn. I'm not getting in the front of that canoe again, and that's final. Do you want to tip over like last time? Molly remembered her plunge into the water. All right, she said. I'll get in the front. But it won't be able to help you paddle. The Red Scout has got to think there's only one of us in the canoe, or she might guess a plan. Well, you lie down, said Susan. The Scout won't be able to see you. So Molly laid down on the bottom of the canoe next to the extra paddle, and Susan pushed off. With Susan paddling, the canoe jerked forward like a darting fish. It rolled from side to side, but it did move. Soon, Susan said, there's a Red Scout. She sees me. Just keep paddling, hissed Molly. They're not far from the island. The canoe zigzagged, sometimes heading away from the island, then heading straight for it. Susan, said Molly, you're supposed to switch your paddle from side to side every few strokes so the canoe will go in a line. I can't do it that way, says Susan shortly. I'm doing it the only way I know how. Maybe that's good, said Molly. It will confuse the Red Scout. She won't be able to figure out what you're trying to do. Now, head for that hidden landing we found last time. In a surprisingly short time, they got to the landing place they found when the canoe tipped over. Susan banged the canoe into the rocks, but she managed to get it into the narrow space. Molly sat up. Okay, she said. Give me your paddle. Here are the worms. The plan was for Molly to paddle the canoe around the beach. Susan would climb around the edge of the island to the prison and free the rest of the Blue Army. Then she would swim out to Molly in the canoe. But Susan held on to the paddle. Listen, she said. The Red Scout just saw me paddling across the lake. Won't she think it's funny if she sees you paddle around to the beach? I think I should stay with the canoe and you should do the worm and prisoner part. Well, that means you have to handle the canoe all by yourself, said Molly. Are you sure you can do it? Susan shrugged. I don't know, she said. I got us this far. Maybe I can do the rest. Anyways, I'll try. Molly looked at Susan. You're pretty brave, she said. You've got the hard part, said Susan. You might get caught by the Red Army. No, said Molly with a little grin. I figure they'll be so busy watching the way you paddle a canoe, they'll never notice me. Susan smiled. Good luck, she said. As Molly scrambled up the rocks, Susan backed the canoe into the lake. Molly moved as quickly as she could, staying very close to the water. For a while, she could see Susan's canoe moving along the shore. Then the canoe disappeared around the point of the island, and Molly couldn't see it anymore. Molly crept around the shore to the prison. She kept a sharp lookout for the Red Army. Suddenly, Molly stopped. There was a surprise. The path was gone. She was standing at the edge of the inlet that cut into the shore of Chocolate Drop Island. Molly could see the prison on the other side of the inlet. Why wasn't this inlet on Dorinda's map? Molly asked herself. The water looked deep. Well, she thought, I'll just have to swim across to get to the prison. There's no other way. She put the can of worms down her undershirt and tucked her shirt tightly into her shorts. Then she waded into the water. When it reached her shoulders, Molly dog paddled as quietly as she could, keeping her head above the water. When she was about halfway across, she stopped. Oh no, she thought. Linda! Linda was walking through the bushes behind the prison. She was coming right towards Molly. Linda's whistle glinted in the sun. Molly held her breath, as if she could make her invisible. If Linda sees me, I'm done for, she thought. The whole Blue Army is done for. But there is no place to hide in the middle of the water. There is no place to go, but down, thought Molly. I'll have to swim underwater. Molly shuddered. I can't make myself do it, she thought. But Linda was coming closer and closer and closer. Quickly, Molly took a deep breath and slid down under the surface. The water swallowed her. She forced herself to open her eyes. Greeny gold sunlight filtered through the water. Plants withered like snakes next to her. Maybe if I move, it won't be so bad, Molly thought. She fluttered her legs and pulled with her arms. The can of worms was cold against her skin. Finally, she couldn't hold her breath any longer. She bobbed up for air. Thank goodness, Linda had turned her back. She was moving away from Molly, watching something out on the big lake, off the opposite end of the beach. It was Susan, waving her paddle around, slapping it against water, calling, Yoo-hoo! Yoo-hoo! The Red Army girls were all watching Susan. They buzzed like confused bees. Get the canoes! We got to take her prisoner! One of the girls yelled. No! She's coming to shore! Yelled another. Susan kept them guessing. She zigzagged towards land one second, then zagged out towards deeper water in the next. But all the while, she was leading the girls farther and farther down the beach, far away from the prison. Only Linda stayed near it, standing guard. Molly scuttled out of the inlet like a crab, keeping an eye on Linda the whole time. She hid behind a bush while she caught her breath, but there was no time to waste. She pulled the lid off the can, sneaked quietly towards the prison. When Linda's back was turned, Molly dashed up behind her and yelled, Worms! She dumped the stuff in the can on Linda's head. Spiders and stems went down the back of Linda's shirt. Sticks and bugs fell all over the place. Worms were caught in her hair. Ugh! Linda howled. Help! She clawed at her hair, trying to pull the worms off. She jumped up and down wildly. Then she turned and saw Molly. You? She cried. Molly froze. She was supposed to take Linda and take her prisoner. She couldn't do it. This was Linda, her friend. She didn't look like the fierce Red army guard anymore. She looked like plain old Linda, and she looked like she was going to cry. Molly ran away. She rushed towards the teammates who were prisoners. Blue Army, you're free, she yelled as she tagged them. Follow me, hurry up. With a great cheer, the Blue Army stampeded out of the prison. Linda didn't stop anyone. She was still pulling worms out of her hair. The Blue Army girls dragged their canoes into the lake, jumped into them, and then paddled furiously, churning the water white. Some girls swam next to the canoes as their buddies paddled, and others had their legs up on one side of their canoes, trying to climb aboard. When the Red Army girls saw what was happening, they ran crazily in all directions. Some headed up the hill to protect the flag. Some ran across the beach towards the prison. Some went to their canoes to try to chase the Blue Army. They were shouting, stumbling, and bumping into one another. Susan paddled her canoe toward Molly, coming up close to the shore. Molly swam as fast as she could to the canoe. Get in," cried Susan. Molly pulled herself up into the canoe. Carefully, Susan leaned all the way to the other side to balance Molly's weight. When she was safe in the canoe, Molly turned back to look at the beach. Linda was standing there all alone. Her hands hung down by her sides. She wasn't even trying to blow her whistle. Molly made herself turn away. She picked up her paddle and followed the rest of the Blue Army back to camp. The war wasn't over yet, but Molly felt as if she already had lost something very important. Chapter 4, Victory at Sea. The Blue Army was rather quiet by the time everyone got back to the boathouse. Here we are, said one girl, right back where we started. Molly looked at the downhearted girls. No one knew what to do. Where's Dorinda? Molly asked. A girl named Marie spoke up. Dorinda wasn't in the same prison with the rest of us. She was in a special captain's prison. She didn't see you. I guess she's still on the island. Serves her right, someone muttered. What will we do now? Asked a tall girl named Shirley. Should we give up? No, said Molly. We can't win the war without Dorinda. But who will be our leader? Asked Marie. I think it should be Molly, said Susan loyally. She thought up the plan to free all of you. I didn't like it, but it worked. She can think up another plan to capture the flag and win the whole color war, can't you, Molly? Yes, said Marie. You can be our captain, Molly. Molly felt a little tickle of pride, but quickly she felt something else, too. What if our army is captured again? Everyone will blame me. I'll be the one who lost the war, she thought. I wonder if this is the way the real leaders feel. I bet they felt this way before D-Day invasion. Molly thought about the newsreel she had seen on the D-Day invasion. The soldiers spilled out of the boats, ran across the beach, scrambled up the rocky cliffs along the shore. Well, Susan asked her, do you have a plan? I was just thinking, said Molly slowly. Our color war is sort of like a real war. We have to do what the Allies did on D-Day. Molly began to talk faster as she got excited. The enemy, the Red Army, knows we're going to try and land and invade their territory, just like the Nazis knew the Allies were going to go and land and invade France. The only thing they didn't know was exactly when and exactly where the Allies would land. Oh, for heaven's sake, said Shirley. In our war, the when is this afternoon and the where is the beach. There's no other time or place. We can't land on the beach again, said Molly, thinking out loud. That's the mistake we made last time. The Red Army will be waiting for us there. We have to land somewhere where they don't expect us. Like where, said Shirley. Molly had an idea. She stepped over the sitting girls and went to the map. Susan and I found a place when we went to the island before, she said. It's right here. Molly pointed to the map. She put her finger on the narrow landing place on Chocolate Drop Island. It's a good place to land because a Red Scout can't see it. It's hidden by a rocky land on one side and trees on the other. Molly read the name off the map. It's called Poison Point. But Molly, Susan piped up, it's an awfully skinny place. Only one canoe can fit in at a time. That's no good then, said Shirley. We can't unload one canoe, then back out, then unload the next. It would take too long. And how would we keep the empty canoes from floating away? We need a long beach or a long dock. Maybe we could build a dock on the island, said Marie. That's silly, said Shirley. No, it isn't, said Molly. She thought of the D-Day newsreels again. We can build a floating dock. That's what the Allies did when they landed in France. Everyone looked blank. Don't you remember the newsreels we saw of D-Day? Molly asked. The Allies built a long, long dock from the deep water all the way to the shore. Remember? They built it out of barges and boats. They could drive trucks off their big ships onto the dock and then all the way to land. I don't get it, said Susan. We don't have barges or anything. What can we use to build a dock? Canoes, said Molly. We can use our canoes. We'll land one canoe at Poison Point. Then we'll tie another canoe to it. We'll tie all the canoes to one another, end to end, in a long row. We can use our Camp Gowanigan ties. Then we'll walk from canoe to canoe onto the island. The girls murmured among themselves. That's crazy, someone said. Yes, but it might work, said Molly. I think we should try it, said Marie. All right then, said Molly. Let's go. Susan was taking one last look at the map. How come that place is called Poison Point, she asked. Are the rocks poison or something? But no one there had the answer to Susan's question. Everyone was climbing back into the canoes. Okay, Molly shouted. I'll give each canoe a number. That'll be your place in line. Susan will be in the first canoe, and I will be in the last one. Molly pointed to each canoe. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Ready? Head out. The Blue Army canoes followed Susan's canoe across the lake. Molly noticed Susan seemed to be paddling much straighter. Her canoe was a little wobbly, but it didn't zig and zag as much as it used to. When they got close to the island, Molly saw the Red Scout watching them. The Scout turned and ran back towards the beach. Good, thought Molly. They'll think we're silly enough to land on the beach again. The Red Army will be there waiting for us. They won't expect us to sneak up on them from behind. Susan slipped her canoe into the landing place at Poison Point. Canoe number 2 pulled up behind her canoe, and Susan tied them together. In no time, all 10 canoes were tied end to end. The girls kept low as they crawled from canoe to canoe onto the island. Canoe number 4 almost turned over, but luckily no one was in it at the time. Molly was the last one across the rickety canoe dock onto the land. Okay, she said to all the girls gathered on the point. Everyone from the first 5 canoes, go around to the beach. You'll have to swim a little, because there's an inlet just before you get to the prison. But you'll be able to sneak up on the Reds from behind the prison. Bring your Red Army prisoners back to camp in their own canoes. Everyone else will come up the hill with me to capture the flag. Let's go. No one moved. What's the matter? Asked Molly, exasperated. We found out why it's called Poison Point, said Susan. This whole place is covered with poison ivy. No one wants to crawl through it. Molly was determined. We can't quit now, she said. We have to. Go on again and try. The girls looked at each other uncomfortably. Molly marched up and sat smack down in the middle of poison ivy. She said, You can win. Go on again and try. The girls giggled. Then Susan climbed up towards Molly. One by one, every girl in the Blue Army followed her. The girls climbed over the rocks, carefully trying to avoid the poison ivy leaves. One group headed towards the beach. The other group followed Molly up Chocolate Drop Hill. At the top of the hill, Molly saw 6 red girls standing guard of the flag. They were sitting in the sun, eating their lunches, so they did not see Molly and the Blue Army sneaking up on them. 1, 2, 3, whispered Molly. She and the girls fanned out. 2 Blue Army girls tagged each of the red guards. Molly rushed to the very top of the hill. She pulled the flag out of the ground and waved it over her head. Hooray! The Blue Army girls cheered, jumping up and down and hugging one another. The red guards were too stunned to do anything. Molly led everyone in a happy race back down the hill to the canoes. No one seemed to worry about the poison ivy on the way down. As Molly's group got back to Poison Point, the rest of the Blue Army girls came paddling around the island in the red canoes they captured. In each canoe, there was 1 Blue Army girl and 2 Red Army prisoners. When the Blue Army girls saw Molly and the flag, they cheered, Yahoo! We win! Hooray! Blue Army! Hooray, Molly! Hooray! Hooray! Molly looked for Linda, but she couldn't find her in the crowd. She did see Dorinda, who was the only Blue Army girl who was not cheering. Molly sat in the middle of a canoe holding the flag above her head. Across the lake they went, the canoes following in a glittery path that made by the afternoon sun. Molly listened to the girls singing, Raise the flag high, never say die, while the red, white, and blue flies above. Their voices were full of happiness. Molly was happy, too. The color war was over. Chapter 5. The Pink Army. Miss Butternut and the counselors were waiting at the boathouse when the girls got back to camp. Molly was very glad to see the camp director's round, cheerful face. She felt relieved when she put the flag into Miss Butternut's hands. Miss Butternut looked a little confused. Congratulations, Blues, she said. Good job, Captain Molly. Oh, I'm not the captain, said Molly. Dorinda is really in charge. I see, said Miss Butternut. She looked over at Dorinda, who was sulky. Well, Miss Butternut said briskly, you can tell us a whole exciting story later. But now, I think everyone on both teams should report to the dining hall for a celebration. Ice cream cones for everyone. Hooray! Ice cream, shouted the girls. They all ran up the hill to the dining hall. As Molly was scooping ice cream into her cone, Miss Butternut said, The counselors and I saw most of what happened. We don't know why it happened that way. Perhaps you can tell us how it was you that ended up capturing the flag, Molly. Molly didn't know where to begin. Well, she started. Susan hurried forward. I'll tell, she said. Molly really saved the day. She did everything. You see, Dorinda was in prison. Actually, everybody in the Blue Army was in prison except for me and Molly, because I tipped over our canoe. Then Molly thought up a plan to throw worms on Linda, because she was a prison guard, so we could free the Blue Army. We freed everybody, all except for Dorinda. Then nobody knew what to do, so Molly thought up another plan. This time, we paddled over to Poison Point. To where? Miss Butternut interrupted. She sounded worried. To Poison Point, Susan said. We climbed. Wait, cried Miss Butternut. She jumped up and stood on a chair. She blew a blast of her bugle and waved her other arm wildly. Everyone was so surprised they were absolutely still. The dining hall had never been so quiet. Girls, girls, said Miss Butternut, stop. Before you get your cones, Everyone who is at Poison Point, go to the showers immediately. I want you to scrub, and I mean scrub, with strong soap. Then report to the camp nurse. Miss Butternut shook her head. I'm afraid it's already too late. The whole bunch of you is going to have a wallop in case of poison ivy. All the girls groaned. Miss Butternut hurried the girls out of the dining hall. Even her hair looked frazzled. Her gray curls were standing out from her head like ruffled feathers. Molly and Susan joined the sad parade. Some victory celebration, sighed Susan. Only the losers go to the party. The winners have to go to the nurse. Discouraged, Molly and Susan plodded up the path to get to their tent to get their towels. Hey, someone shouted. They turned around. It was Linda. Wait up, she said. When Linda caught up to them, she was panting. Here, she said. She gave them each an ice cream cone. Gee, thanks, said Susan. She was much cheerier. It's nice of you to bring us ice cream. We thought you were mad at us about the worms. Molly looked at Linda out of the corner of her eye. Well, said Linda a little sheepishly, I was mad, but then I figured you were mad at me for blowing the whistle on you. We were surprised, said Molly. We didn't expect you to be so serious about the game. Linda shrugged. I guess I kind of wanted the counselors to be proud of me, she said. Oh, said Molly. Well, if you ask me, it was all very mixed up day. No one acted normal, said Susan. She had a dab of ice cream on her nose. You were so serious we had to throw worms at you. I spent the whole day in a canoe, and Molly swam underwater, even though no one asked her to. Linda turned to Molly. No kidding, she asked. You swam underwater? Yes, said Molly. I did. Gosh, said Linda. Then you do deserve to win the color war. Molly grinned. I don't think anybody really won the war. I'm just glad it's over. Me too, said Linda. Me too, said Susan. Now we can all have fun together, like before. Yes, said Molly. I don't want to be red or blue or any other color ever again. By the next morning, Molly, Susan, and almost everyone else at camp was another color. Poison ivy pink. Okay, my friends, so that brings us to the end of Molly Saves the Day. I hope you enjoyed it. Check out other videos to hear other Molly stories, and you can also check out other weeks for Felicity stories, Kirsten stories, and Samantha stories. We'll see you soon. Bye!